Thanks for the invitation to speak here. It's really great. It's good to hang out with all my three manifold topology friends and my contact topology friends. So everything I'm going to say is joint with Steven Sivak. So let me start by phrasing a question. Sort of a very vague question, which is the following. So which three manifolds arise as day in surgery? On a knot in S3. So we take a knot in S3, we remove a tubular neighborhood, we re-glue it back in, and we want to see what kinds of manifolds we can obtain. Okay, so that's the question. Let's start with some very basic properties of Dane surgery. So the first thing to think about is if we do P over Q surgery on a knot K, and we look at the first homology, then we know that this is cyclic of order P. So in particular, we already have some constraints on the three manifolds that we can get. You know, for instance, we can't get T3. We know from Licorice and Wallace that we can get every three manifold by surgery on some link in S3. So in some sense, this is sort of the first step to trying to understand three manifolds. And already we know we can only get so far. Another property worth looking at is the fundamental group. So let's study the fundamental group of surgery on a knot. Well, what we do is we start with the fundamental group of the exterior. And then when we do Dane surgery, we're basically just attaching a disc along the slope mu to the p, lambda to the q, and then a three ball. So in other words, we're just attaching the relationship, the relation mu to the p, lambda to the q. Right. This group is normally generated by the meridian. And therefore, this whole element, this whole group is normally generated by the meridian. So this is a weight one group. It's normally generated by one element. So again, we get some extra constraints on the manifolds that arise by surgery on a knot. OK. Now, sort of one of the sort of amazing results about Dane surgery is that if we do surgery on sort of a sufficiently generic knot, say let's say a hyperbolic knot, then most of the time we're going to get something hyperbolic. So surgery on a hyperbolic knot, let's say, is generically hyperbolic. And by generic, I mean all but finitely many surgeries. Okay. So rather than, even though that's sort of the generic case, what I'd like to study or talk about today is the exceptional case. So what happens when we get non-hyperbolic manifolds when we do Dane surgery? So let me convince you that some interesting things can happen. So let's look at 6 surgery on the right-handed trefoil. And it turns out that not only is this not hyperbolic, it's actually reducible. So we're going to get RP3 connect some L32. So let's see why this is true. So we'll do a little bit of Kirby calculus. So here's our surgery presentation for RP3 connect some L32. And I'm going to handle slide the 2 over the minus 3. And so we get a 2-6 torus link, where one of these still has framing minus 3, but the other one, which say this one, has framing minus 1. And now we can blow down the minus 1, get a minus 1 over here. And what we're left with is the trefoil, the right-handed trefoil, with framing plus 6. So the linking number here is 3. So when we blow it down, we add 3 squared to minus 3 and get 6. And the minus 1 is just an S3. So we're left with 6 surgery on the trefoil. So here's a way to see that we can do something, you know, take a fairly simple knot, do a surgery on it, and some interesting phenomenon can occur. Okay, great. So maybe you don't like Kirby calculus, and maybe you like groups. Everyone likes groups. So let's look at a slightly different example. Let's look at PQ surgery on the PQ torus knot. So that encompasses this example here. Well, what are we going to do? We're going to look at pi 1 of the complement. And then we're going to add this relation, mu to the PQ, mu to the PQ lambda. Okay. So what is this group? Well, we know that the knot group for the torus knot, PQ torus knot, has two generators, x and y. X to the p equals y to the q is our one relation. And it turns out that the longitude can be expressed as x to the p mu to the pq x to the p. Doesn't matter because x to the p is central anyways. But so when we add in this relation, minus sign there. So when we add in this relation, we just kill off this x to the p. And so we're left with z mod p, free product z mod q. There's a great fact about three manifolds, which is if you see it in the fundamental group, then it's there. And so in fact, the theorem of Whitehead tells us that since this looks like the fundamental group of a connected sum, it is a connected sum. And so we get that S3PQTPQ is a connected sum of two manifolds whose fundamental group are cyclic. And now let's just appeal to geometrization, because why not? And so we see that we're going to get two Lens spaces. This is necessarily a connect sum of two Lens spaces. So let's say LP something connect sum L something. And it turns out that what we see respectively here are q and p. So one can sort of see this on the level of the fundamental group. There are lots of ways to verify this, but hopefully there's some evidence that we can get surgeries that are giving us things which are non-prime. OK, great. Let me just point out one more example of this kind of phenomenon. So sort of a slight generalization of this. So if we do PQ surgery on a PQ cable of K, and so here I'll use the same conventions as Cameron, where we're going to wind longitudinally P times. This is going to be LPQ, connect some, not quite LQP, but a surgery on the original knot, on our companion knot. So in fact, we can get things like Lens space connect some a hyperbolic manifold if we pick some knot which was, say, hyperbolic and had lots of hyperbolic surgeries. OK, great. So a natural question we can ask is, how else can we get reducible manifolds? Could we do surgery on a hyperbolic knot and get something reducible? And the conjecture is that this is the only thing we can do. So we have the cabling conjecture. Due to Gonzalez Acuna and Short, which says this is it. So say, non-prime. So the only way we can get non-prime surgeries is if we started with a knot that was a cabled knot. And sort of the goal, so far, flows, foliations, and contact structures, none of these have appeared yet. So the goal is to try to take some information from contact topology and apply it to study this problem. So I can at least get 2 out of 3. Let me make a remark, right, that if we do non-prime surgeries, well, then we can't have top foliations, right? So and so if somehow if we magically came across some hyperbolic knots with reducible surgeries, then we could obstruct certain slopes from coming from top foliations on a knot complement hitting our boundary in certain ways. This conjecture is certainly true, so that's not going to happen. But it's just something to keep in mind. OK, great. Any questions? OK, great. So let's review a few useful facts that what's known about the cabling conjecture. So the first, due to Gordon and Lukey, is we could look at, say, what kinds of slopes can we see if we were going to get a non-prime surgery. So, well, the surgery slope has to be integral. Is a result of theirs. And further, we can actually constrain the kinds of summands we can see. So they also tell us that there exists a non-trivial lens space summand. Now, notice that if you have a non-trivial lens space summand, you have non-trivial torsion in your first homology. And already, we then know that we can't get, say, homology spheres or homology S2 times S1s arising as a reducible surgery. Non-prime surgery. Another result due to Matignon and Sayari tell us that the surgery coefficient cannot be too big. So let's say if we're not in the case of a cable, if we were to have some purported counterexample, then the surgery coefficient is governed by the genus of our knot. Let me list a few more properties, and then we'll actually start proving things. You could ask about the number of summands which could occur. This is also very heavily constrained. So there's actually at most 3 summands. And if you see 3, if something very specific has to happen, it's got to be, well, there's this requisite lens space, then another lens space, and then an integer homology sphere. So if you have a lot of summands, something very specific has to occur. Okay. So even if k is a cable, so if you believe the cabling conjecture, and then you also use 1, then that'll actually tell you that you can only have 2 summands. So for the case of cables, it's known that you only get 2 summands. Basically, because of this, this is telling you that one of the surgeries is non-integral. Great. Other questions? Okay, so. We could ask about the kinds of knots that could be counterexamples. And so work of Moser and Charlemagne, and also including some work of Cameron and other people as well. Yes. You can say the cabling conjecture holds for any non-hyperbolic knot. And so that's really what we're going to be interested in is for hyperbolic knots today. So if you go to a talk on the cabling conjecture, I think you always see at least these four results show up. There's something that I think people don't point out enough. And so let me point out a slightly more obscure result. So there's another result of Gonzalez. Well, there's a result of Gonzalez, Acuna, and Short, which says the following if you have a fibered knot. So if K is fibered, and the surgery coefficient is very large, so strictly bigger than the genus, then there's an interesting condition on the homology of our manifold. So let me say the non-Lens space summand, or the non-Lens space piece, I guess it could be two pieces, it has non-trivial homology. So if you do very large surgery on a fibered knot, there's some very interesting homology going on. And in particular, this implies that the surgery coefficient is composite. Maybe I should add, and maybe I need non-cabled just in case. Okay, so here are some facts. So a lot of information is known. But let me just point out one final result of these properties is that if we take 1 and 2 and we put them together, then we see that the cabling conjecture holds for genus 1 knots. So this is originally proved by Boyer and Zhang, but a quick corollary of these two properties also does this. So we'll be sort of interested in knots with large genus today. Okay, so now the contact topology is going to appear. So so let's suppose we have a Legendrian knot. And for us, we'll just look at Legendrian knots in S3 with the standard type contact structure. So we'd like to extract some data from this. And so let me just remind you that we can define the Thurston-Beneken number to be, well, when we look at the front projection, and I'll just draw an example in a second to keep in mind, we look at the writhe of the diagram minus the number of cusps. So one half the number of cusps. So let's do an example. So here we have a Legendrian right-handed trefoil. So this is what we see here. These are the cusps. And our writhe is 3 in this diagram. And so we see that the Thurston-Beneken number of this Legendrian knot is 1. Oh, great. So here's some contact topological data that we can extract. And there's just somehow we'd like to turn this into a purely topological invariant so we can actually make some statements about the cabling conjecture that make no reference to contact topology. So, first let's notice that we can do stabilizations. So given a Legendrian knot, we have a couple ways we can stabilize it to get a different Legendrian knot. And so when we do this, we change the Thurston-Benikin number by one, decreases by one, because we're adding cusps, so we're not changing the writhe. So somehow we can get very, very negative Thurston-Benikin numbers. But what we'll be interested in is large Thurston-Benikin numbers. So we have the maximum Thurston-Benikin number of any knot, which is going to just be the maximum over all Legendrian representatives of a given isotopy type. And so this is some purely topological invariant, and it is finite. So in fact, we have the bound max TB of any knot is at most twice the genus minus 1. And you could replace this with the four-ball genus, or by Olga's work, you can replace it by tau or the S invariant. But we just really care about the fact that it's bounded in terms of the genus. Okay. Great. So now let's obstruct some reducible surgeries. So the first result, so again, this is all joint with Steven Sivak. So the first result is going to tell us something about surgery coefficients relative to the Thurston-Benikin number. So suppose we have a knot whose maximal Thurston-Benikin number is at least 0. Then we have the following constraints. So we can say that any surgery on our knot is prime as long as it's less than this maximal Thurston-Benikin number. So, you know, we might want to ask, well, you know, what kinds of knots have this property, or how big of a Thurston-Benikin number can we actually realize so that we can obstruct more and more surgeries? And so, for instance, there's a nice family of knots we can look at. Well, we can't go better than 2g minus 1, but we can hit those. So a nice family to look at are positive knots. And since every positive knot has the largest possible Thurston-Benikin number, so if we have this condition, let's say, and k is not a cable, if we had some reducible surgery or some non-prime surgery, well, then by this result, we know that it's got to be at least 2g minus 1. But we also know that the surgery coefficient has to be at most 2g minus 1. So there's exactly one possible surgery coefficient. So we're going to get something very specific. The surgery coefficient is exactly twice the genus minus 1. There's only one possible reducible surgery on a positive knot, for instance.
What is a positive knot?
Oh, a positive knot is just a diagram, a knot that has a diagram where when you orient it, say every crossing looks like this. So every crossing is right-handed. Great. Other questions? Great. But this is somehow really dissatisfying, right? We can't even say the cabling conjecture holds for this knot. We haven't written down any knots. So let's add more conditions until we have a theorem. So why not? OK, so let's say we have a positive knot, and it's fibered. So maybe we look at a positive braid closure or some other nice positive knot. And let's add one more condition. Sorry, I just love adding hypotheses. So let's suppose that 2g of k minus 1 is prime. So now prime is a number, not as a 3 manifold. Well, then we can actually say the cabling conjecture holds for R not K. So why is this? Well, once we add the fibered condition, we can apply this strange condition number 5 that tells us that, you know, if we have a large surgery, the surgery coefficient has to be composite. In this case, the surgery coefficient is not composite. Say, take any, this should be concrete, right? So let's take G at most 7. So we actually have knots that realize this. And so we can establish the cabling conjecture for some very special families of knots. Yes? Any knot with max TB equals 2G minus 1. That's exactly right. So for instance, you know, lots of L space knots, for instance, have this max TB equals 2G minus 1. Great. Let me point out one more result that sort of follows from similar arguments. I'm going to mainly talk about theorem 1, but if you do a little bit more work and you add in some techniques from Haggard Floer homology, then you can prove the following. So we can get the cabling conjecture for some families of knots. So say for genus 2 positive knots. So here we can throw away the fiberedness condition, but we have to really restrict the genus. So in sort of all of these examples, we're seeing these knots that have very, you know, presumably interesting non-negative or very positive Thurston-Benikin, maximal Thurston-Benikin number. So you could ask, can you throw this condition away? And it turns out roughly the answer is no. So let me point out a recent theorem of Yasui, which says the following. So there are some n minus 1 cables which have maximal Thurston-Benikin number equal to minus 1. So what does this say? Well, we could look at the reducible surgery on here. That surgery coefficient is negative n. So negative n surgery is not prime. And so in fact, what this tells us is we can find surgeries that are arbitrarily below the maximal Thurston-Benikin number that are in fact prime, or non-prime, sorry. And so somehow, one, you know, these restrictions cannot be completely removed. So there's a little bit of work you can do where if you have negative maximal Thurston-Benikin number, you can add some extra conditions and get some analogous results. But sort of this statement as it holds is not true. So I should say, so what are we actually going to hopefully accomplish during this talk is we're going to basically, after black boxing a few more facts, we're just going to prove theorem 1. So any questions before we do that? Great.
So like we
heard about in Laura's talk, we could study the topology or the contact topology of manifolds by looking at the kind of symplectic four manifolds that, say, a given contact manifold can bound.
And so I'm going to look at a very specific
family of such symplectic manifolds. We're going to look at Stein fillings, or Stein manifolds. And so we're going to sort of build some, we're going to basically put contact structures on these surgered manifolds and use those contact structures to actually see what kinds of reducible manifolds could we get by surgery. So let me just, so rather than saying what a Stein structure is, let me just appeal to a theorem, theorems of Eliasberg and Gompf, which basically allow us to give a more combinatorial description of what a Stein structure on a four manifold is. So I'll say a Stein structure on a four manifold X is just going to be a nice handle body decomposition. So, so this is going to be particularly simple. So, well, okay, so zero handles are going to be okay. One handles are okay. We're not going to allow three or four handles, and we're going to allow very specific kinds of two handles. So it's going to be two handles, and we're going to specify the way they're attached. So they're going to be attached along Legendrians, and we actually want to remember the Legendrian type. And the framing is going to be very precise. The framing is going to be exactly the Thurston-Benneken number of that Legendrian minus one. So a handle body decomposition where we just see some zero handles, some one handles, some Legendrian knots, and we see precisely this framing. Okay. So what do we actually need about this is that a Stein structure, well, this is going to give us a tight contact structure on the boundary. And so we're going to look at the kinds of tight contact structures we can get on the on these kinds of manifolds, and that's going to tell us something about the Dane surgeries. Yes?
I'm really not sure that either Eliasberg or Gompf would be happy to see their name attached to this definition. Maybe at least you could put a Stein handle body structure on
the Yes. And say a Stein handlebody structure. Great. Yes, it's very abusive. Okay, great. Okay, great. So what's the point? Okay, so we're going to black box two facts about Stein fillings or Stein structures, and then we're just going to use that to immediately see some constraints on the topology of reducible surgeries. So the first, which we'll really see is going to get us off the ground, is the following. So if we have a Stein filling, of some non-prime three manifold, so we have some compact manifold and it has non-prime boundary, that actually tells us that the four manifold in some appropriate sense is non-prime. So X decomposes as a boundary sum. X1 boundary sum X2, where each of these is a Stein filling of each of the pieces. So these are Stein. And the boundaries of the Xi's are these yi's. Okay. And the other result, well, okay, so you can see what's going to happen. We're going to look at a surgery. It's going to be a connected sum. So we're going to look at a Stein filling, split that up. Now we know we're going to see a lens space popping out, so we should try to understand something about what kinds of fillings of lens spaces we can have. And so, for example, we have some constraints on Stein fillings of lens spaces. So if W is Stein with boundary a lens space, then there's no surfaces of positive self-intersection. So B2 plus of W is 0. So all we need are these two facts, and then we can do some elementary algebraic topology and actually say something about reducible surgeries. Okay, so to give some evidence, let's reprove an old result of Etnayer and Honda. So they sort of were going the opposite direction. They were using reducible surgeries on torus knots to study maximal Thurston-Benikin numbers. And we're going to use Thurston-Benikin numbers to study reducible surgeries on knots. But we're going to use their proposition, or prove their proposition, which is the following. So if we have some number less than the maximal Thurston-Benikin number of our knot, and we did a non-prime surgery, then we get lots of constraints. So let's write this as a lens space, connect something else. We don't know what it is. Then we have the following. So first of all, we can constrain the non-lens space piece. So we're going to see that y is the boundary of some z. Well, every three-manifold is the boundary of some four-manifold, but z is going to be contractible. And if we have a three-manifold that's the boundary of a contractible four-manifold, then it's a homology sphere. So right away, we would know that the first homology of y is 0. And so all of the homology is carried by this lens space. So we see the size of the lens space. So the size of the lens space is exactly given by the surgery coefficient. We don't know the sign, so let's say absolute value of n. Now we had, it's gone. But so remember, if we had three sumands, or more than three sumands, we saw lens space, prime integer homology sphere. Okay? But now we see lens space, integer homology sphere. There's no room for a second lens space. And so we already now see that our y is prime. So once we get this contractible thing bounding y, we're going to get lots of additional constraints. And we still haven't really said anything about the surgery coefficient or about the knot. So we will also get that as well. We'll get that the surgery actually has to be negative. Okay, great. So questions about the proposition before we prove it? We're always doing integral surgery because that's right, exactly. Okay, great. So let's prove this. Okay, so we kind of know what we want to do, right? We want to build a Stein manifold for which our three manifold, our surgered manifold, is the boundary, and then see what we get. So how are we going to do that? Well, to get a Stein manifold, we need to build a handle body decomposition where we see some Legendrians with framing TB minus 1. And since our surgery coefficient is less than the maximal Thurston-Benikin number, we're going to be able to do that. So let's pick a Legendrian representative. let's say K with TB minus 1 equals our surgery coefficient. So how can we do that? Well, you know, we know at least we can get something with the maximal TB. So if we pick something and it's, say, maybe too big, then we just stabilize it. So we maybe have to stabilize some choice. But once we know we can get something bigger than n, we can stabilize until we get something with exactly n plus 1. OK, so now we have a Stein manifold. What is it? Let's construct it. So we're just going to take a zero handle, and then we're going to attach. We're going to attach an n-framed two-handle along our Legendrian. So let's call this x, and this is Stein. It has a Stein structure. We've explicitly given it. And its boundary is precisely surgery on our knot, which is our purportedly, you know, maybe our purported connected sum. So maybe we got something LPQ connect sum y. Okay. So now what we're going to do is we're going to just split our Stein filling. Right? X is now Stein filling a connected sum, so we can break it into two pieces. So by fact one, X splits. Let's call it the two pieces W and Z. Both of these are Stein, have Stein structures. And they're filling, let's say W is filling the lens space, and Z is filling this other piece Y. We don't know what it is. Okay. Great. Let's do algebraic topology. Okay. Great. What's pi 1 of X? Right, it's 0. There's no one handles. Great. And so we see that W and Z are also simply connected as well. OK. We had no 3 or 4 or higher handles. So we know that HI is going to be 0 for any I at least 2, and consequently the same for W and Z. And we just attached one two-handle. Sorry? Oh, 3, 3, 3. Thank you. Yes. I at least 3, right? We care about 2. That's what the space is for. So we have the second homology of X. We've just attached one two-handle. There's no one-handle. There's no three-handle. And so this is Z. And it splits over the second homology of W and Z. So one of them is going to be Z. One of them is going to be 0. OK, great. So here's the quiz. Which one has the non-trivial second homology? Yes, it's going to be W, because W has no pi 1 or h 1, but its boundary has some interesting h 1. So I don't know. I won't. OK, no. So h 2 of W is Z. And h 2 of Z is 0. OK. So Z has no pi 1, and it has no homology. So we use our favorite 1-2 punch in algebraic topology, and we see that Z is necessarily contractible, right, by Whitehead and by Hurevich. OK, so what did that tell us? So now we see that Y is the boundary of something contractible, and then we got those other conditions immediately. And so now we're interested in the surgery coefficient. So, great. Okay, so now here's part two of the quiz, I guess. So what's the intersection form on this four manifold W? Right, it has to be N, because there was no homology in Z, and we just attached this one N frame two handle. And as Patrick was saying, well, now we have that W is a, the boundary of W is a Lens space. And so we know this has to be negative definite. And so therefore we, well, then we know that this can't be positive, because then we'd have something with positive self-intersection. And so therefore, by two, we see that N is strictly less than zero. Great. And these are the things that we wanted to show. So all we did was, I mean, these are deep theorems, but once we had these deep facts, we were really easily able to constrain what we could get for reducible surgeries on knots. Questions? Okay, great. So let's do a little bit more. So we know the surgery coefficient is negative. Let's try to rule out some positive surgery coefficients. Let's try to rule out some negative surgery coefficients. Yes. Okay, so let me remind you of the theorem that I promised we would prove. So so we have a knot, and now the maximal Thurston-Benikin number is at least zero. Then we want to just say that we can't get any surgeries that are non-prime where that surgery coefficient is less than the Thurston-Benikin number. So is prime. Okay, great. So what are we going to do? So we're going to play the same game. So we're going to say, okay, we're going to take our knot, we're going to find this nice two handle, attach it, look at the Stein manifold, and play around with that. But so far, we haven't really used any actual contact topology in some sense. We haven't said, well, we get a tight contact structure on here, what can we say about that? So now we're going to look at a tight contact structure on the boundary and get some extra information. So we're going to be a little bit more careful. So let's suppose that we have our surgery, and it's something non-prime. So it looks like some Lens space connects some something else. And we know that N is negative, so N has to be less than 0 by our proposition. And we know that N has to be this, determines the size of this Lens space. So let's write, say, NQ. Right? The Lens space carries everything. And we know that N has to be less than 0 by our proposition. We know a little bit more, in fact. Well, we have this non-trivial Lens space summand, so there's torsion in our homology. And so then that tells us that, in fact, N couldn't be minus 1, because then we'd be getting a homology sphere. So in fact, right, since somehow the order of H1 is non-zero, or 1. 1, I guess. OK, great. So basically, what that's telling us is our surgery is way below the maximal Thurston-Benikin number. And so when we go through this process, we pick our knot, and we stabilize, we're going to have to stabilize maybe a lot of times to get to something with TB equals N plus 1. So, but let's do it. So where are we going to do that?
So let's fix our knot
and fix a Legendrian representative, which is as big as possible. So let's say K, sort of maximum Thurston-Benikin number as big as we can go. And so now we want to play this game where we're going to stabilize it, get something with TB equals n plus 1, build the Stein manifold, and go. So let's do that. So we stabilize. So we stabilize K. Remember, we had two options. So we stabilize this way, or we stabilize the other way. And each time we stabilize, we lower Thurston-Benikin number by 1. So TB goes to TB minus 1. And so we're going to stabilize until we get a nice representative with the right Thurston-Benikin number. So until we get a representative with TB minus 1 is exactly the surgery coefficient we're interested in, so we can build this nice Stein manifold. Sorry? Oh, yeah, sorry. I'm really optimistic. OK, so TB equals TB max. Thank you. Great. So now we're going to stabilize it down some number of times. And how many times do we need to stabilize it? I guess we need to stabilize it TB max minus 1 minus n times. And so, well, if our TB is at least 0 that we started with, then we see that this number is at least absolute value of n minus 1. Okay. But at each time that we stabilize, we have two choices, right? I could stabilize this way, and then when I stabilize again, I could stabilize this way. Or if I was going to stabilize twice, maybe I stabilize this way two times. So we have lots of different ways that we could do these stabilizations. And so that'll give us lots of different Legendrian knots. So we get at least n different Legendrians with TB minus 1 equals n. So by different, I don't really mean different. I just mean that, you know, we could take different sequences of stabilizations. Maybe we end up at the same knot. But sort of we have at least n a priori maybe different Legendrians. And so now we can build these Stein structures for each of these Legendrians. So we get at least n Stein structures on this associated x, where x is the x that we constructed here, where we just took a four ball and we attached this end frame two handle. Okay, so we have at least n Stein structures on x, and so those give us at least n Stein structures on this manifold W. Remember, what was W? That was the one that was filling our lens space, right? So for each of these Stein structures, we split it in half and look at the Stein filling of the lens space. And so with this, well, each of those Stein structures, well, that gives us a tight contact structure on the boundary. So we get a tight contact structure on the boundary. OK, but some of them are maybe the same, maybe bad. In fact, sort of only, you really only get that about half of them are actually distinct in a nice way. Great, exactly. So So what we can do is we can compute the D3 invariants of these tight contact structures. And because the Y part bounds a contractible Stein manifold, the D3 invariant there is going to be 0 or minus 1/2, whatever you get for a contractible Stein manifold. And so that's going to actually turn out to be saying that all of anything you can distinguish on the whole four manifold, you can just distinguish on the W part. Yeah, I'm sort of sweeping the details under the rug for the last couple minutes. Sorry. OK, so once we have that, so you do some more work. Well, not really much more work. You also add in the conjugate, their conjugate spin C structures. And that actually allows you to get n distinct tight contact structures. On LNQ. So if you're just careful and you keep track of all these contact structures and maybe you do a little bit more work to produce some more, you get lots of tight contact structures on this Lens space. But this is bad. So why is this bad? Well, this is just way too many tight contact structures. So it contradicts a result of Giroux and of Honda, where they classify the tight contact structures on Lens spaces. And in particular, they say there aren't too many. In fact, there's only at most the number, the order of the Lens space minus 1 tight contact structures. So we produce too many tight contact structures by looking at these Stein fillings. And so something we did was wrong, and so we have a contradiction. And so in fact, our surgery had to be primed to begin with. You know, one could ask a question, can you do this for other exceptional surgeries? Can you bring in Stein topology and contact topology to study toroidal surgeries or anything like this? So I'll stop there.